fixed point numbers and floating point numbers, the two fundamental formats for expressing numbers on a digital system. They both have their advantages, their areas of usage where they absolutely shine, and they both fall short or completely fail in other aspects. There's no one over the other. As audio and DSP enthusiasts, we need to know where a particular format is preferred and under what circumstances they fall short. Why do digital playback hardware prefer fixed point numbers? Why do DAW softwares prefer to work with floating point numbers? What even is a double precision number? And what number format would you use when implementing a DSP algorithm? This video and the next few in the series will address these questions and a lot more. This video in particular will be about fixed point numbers or integer numbers, and the next ones will be about floating point numbers. Both videos will have the same general topics outlined. We'll start off with what the number format is and what it looks like and how to visualize it, the range of numbers it can hold, and an overview of the arithmetic operations that can be performed on them, the computational limitations of these number formats, and the applications that they're good at. I just want to make a quick note before we start. This video and the next will get aggressively technical as we proceed through the list of topics. It may not be incredibly useful to musicians and producers, so if you feel a bit overwhelmed by the content, or if you don't perceive any use for it, feel free to skip this one. But if you're getting into audio programming or DSP programming, this is meant to serve as a fundamental cornerstone on how basic arithmetic operations happen in the digital system. Alright, let's get started. I've already talked about binary numbers and binary representation in computers in the video on bit depth. So just to whiz through, digital systems, like computers, represent and store information as a series of binary bits. Each bit has only two possible values, 1 or 0, on or off. And the number of unique combinations possible with n bits is 2 to the power of n. So 4 bits can store 16 different possible values, 8 bits can store 256 distinct values, 32 bits can store a whopping 4.3 billion unique state values. So you can see an exponential growth on the order of 2. Take this 8-digit binary number, 01000001. What does it mean? Without context, it means nothing. It's just one combination of 8 bits. It's meaningless. You can choose to give it some meaning based on some rules. This number can be interpreted as the decimal number 65. Or it can be interpreted as the English alphabet A. Or it can be interpreted as a word, like hat. As long as your rules apply consistently across a set of binary numbers, your rule can be whatever you want it to be. Of course, a rule is quite useless if nobody follows it. So there has to be a generally accepted way to view this binary number, such that everyone or everything that encounters this number interprets it the same way. How did we interpret the decimal number 65 from it? The binary system is just another number system. The digits are ordered from right to left being the most significant digit and the right being the least significant digit. And each digit has an index, starting from an index of 0 on the right to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 on the left. And the value of each digit on its own is just the base of the number system to the power of the index. Here it's just 2 to the power of the index. The thing is, we all intuitively know this, but our intuition is only for decimal numbers. We don't tend to think about it in this calculative sense when we encounter numbers day to day. Take the number 123. What's the value of this number? Well, it's 123. We don't really have to think too much about it. But what's the weight of each digit? The base of the number system is 10. The indices starting from the right is 0, 1, and 2. The weight of each digit is 10 to the power of the index. So that's 3, 20, and 100. The total value of the number is just a simple addition of these weights. 100 plus 20 plus 3, 123. These sort of verbose calculations aren't very useful when you're working within the same number system. But when you're converting between two number systems, it's quite useful. In our case, except for the 0th digit and the 6th digit, the rest of the digits is 0. Anything multiplied by 0 is 0, so we can ignore them. The 0th power of 2 is 1, and the 6th power of 2 is 64. So just add the results together and you get the decimal number 65. Just a simple conversion from the binary number system to the decimal number system. So far, we've looked at whole numbers or natural numbers where they're all positive. But of course, numbers can be negative, and more often than not, they are in the audio domain. So we need to be able to represent integer numbers. A number can be a fractional value as well, so being able to represent rational numbers is quite useful as well. So in digital systems, we have a fixed number of bits that we can store our numbers in. So the easiest and most obvious strategy is representing the numbers such that the difference between the consecutive numbers is always the same. So this means we put a linear spread of values into the available range. For example, take 8 bits of storage. We can technically represent 2 to the power of 8 or 256 distinct values here. So there are plenty of ways we can linearly spread the values within this range. We can go from 0 to 255. All numbers are positive. This is also called an unsigned representation because the sign of the number is kind of pointless since we have agreed to store only positive numbers. The difference between any two consecutive numbers in this range is always 1. If you want negative numbers as well, we can sacrifice one bit to store the sign, usually the leftmost bit. And we can use the rest of the 7 bits to represent the magnitude of the number. If the sign bit is 0, the number is positive. And if it's 1, then it's negative. So we can technically store a range of values from negative 127 to positive 127. And again, the difference between each consecutive number is 1. This is called the sign and magnitude representation. This may look good on paper and is quite intuitive for us to understand, but it's not really efficient when implemented in hardware. So there's another representation model called 2's complement that's predominantly used everywhere. We'll look at that soon. Another representation model is to normalize the range and represent values between positive 1 and negative 1. So all numbers would be fractional in this case. Going with the same route as above, sacrificing one bit for sign, we can represent a range of values from 0.9921875 to -0.9921875 with a constant difference between two consecutive numbers being 0.0078125. Okay, that's super unintuitive. How did we get there? When we determined the weight of each number by considering the index, we assumed an invisible binary point to the right of the number. Similar to decimal points, a binary point, or more generally a radix point, splits the number between the whole part and the fractional part. When no radix point is found, we generally assume that 1 is present to the right of the number, or the right of the least significant bit. But the radix point could be at any arbitrary position. If the point is over here, we call this binary 8,5 representation, where you have a total of 8 bits, and the radix point is on the 5th position. In our case, where we were purely representing fractional numbers, the radix point was over here. Essentially, this last bit was used for maintaining the sign, and if you had wanted to represent an unsigned fractional number, the radix point would have been at the left-hand side of these 8 bits, or the left of the most significant bit. The index of each digit depends on its position with respect to the radix. So going towards the right side from the radix, the index is going from negative 1 all the way to negative 7. The weight of the digit is still 2 to the power of the index, so when we calculate the weights of the digits, we get the following values. Fractional parts are particularly hard to get a handle on from the lens of a different number system. But look at this number in binary. It's simple and computable for a computer. In fact, the position of the radix makes near to no difference when the producer of the data and the consumer of the data agree upon the same position for the binary point beforehand. It could be here, here, or here. The range may vary, but the arithmetic operations on it stay consistent, irrespective of where the radix is. More about this later. But we can generalize a number with a specified radix position as being a fixed point number. The fixed point here is the binary point, which separates the whole part from the fractional part. Generally speaking, the binary point is either to the left of the MSP, where the number is purely fractional. This sort of representation is quite commonly used in hardware playback units and rudimentary DSP converters. Or the binary point is to the right of the LSP, where the numbers can only be integers. This representation is probably the most widely used. In most programming languages like C or C++ or Java, fixed point numbers are represented purely as integers. And in most operating systems and modern architectures, an integer or an int represents 4 bytes of data, or 32 bits of resolution. A good reason why this representation is used over the other is no matter how big the resolution grows, the difference between two consecutive numbers is always the same. It's 1. Numbers where the binary point isn't either of the two positions and is some position in the middle is rarely ever used in audio. If you want this sort of behavior, you'll have to write your own implementation for it.